Oh, are we going to have rap? That sounded like we were going to have rap or something. You can be seated. Praise God. Our 2016 graduates, aren't we excited? Dawson doesn't act excited at all. Can y'all get that? You have? You ready to move on? Oh, I know. No, I'm talking about excited about graduating. You're not excited? Well, Mom's not excited either because she don't want you to graduate, right? And I know Angela and BJ, I spent an afternoon with them yesterday. Man, all they did was talk about their boy. Can you imagine that? So it's a big deal in the life of parents to have children who reach adulthood and who leave their high school and go on, you know, out into the deep, dark world and have to stand on their own two feet and hopefully... You know, some of us want them to stay with us forever, and others of us, you know, kind of push them out. So I don't know if that's a mom-dad thing or what. But God has been gracious to these two young men to allow them to come to this place in their life where they're able to stand. They've stood in front of the world system, and now they're able to stand in front of God's kingdom and stand knowing that these two young men have a call on their life. If you didn't know that, I'm sure most of you know. You know, you look at Stephen, and we watched Stephen grow up from a little tiny boy, and we watched Dawson grow up from a little tiny boy, and, you know, it's amazing to see the call of God that is on these two young men's life. And I believe that this is a part of the generation that's going to change the destiny of what we call church. Amen. So, church is changing. And with it, leaders are emerging and arising. And I believe today that we have standing before us not just two high school graduates, you know, glad to be out of high school, but we have two young men who are destined for greatness in the kingdom of God. And I believe that deserves a round of applause. I'm going to start with Dawson, and I'm not making... You want to stand up here, Dawson, while I do that? Okay. You are so cute. Aren't they cute? All right, I'm going to start with Dawson alphabetically, so we don't have any... They're both our favorites. Well, we're just let that speak for itself, okay? Dawson Eli Denham. Dawson came into the world 18 years ago, and we knew from the start of his life that he was meant to be great. How many believe that? Amen. Woohoo! Yes. So here's a few facts about Dawson you may know or you can learn. Dawson weighed 9 pounds, 15 ounces when he was born. He had a pacifier until he was 3, one in his mouth and 2 in each hand, just in case, until he started pre-K. That he didn't want, Mom, he didn't want that to be told. He loved the mud, okay, and sitting in the refrigerator, toilet, or anything, anywhere else that he could crawl in. He really believed he was Batman and a policeman and a WWE wrestler that may have been due to Blake and his friends. He always had God's favor. Amen. He was the only Denham grandchild who could pick his grandmother's flowers and not get a whipping. Just ask Naomi, David, and Blake. He loves music, all kinds. He taught himself at a young age to play the drums, guitar, and piano, and sing. He played football from Little League to junior high when he decided his face was too pretty for that. With his mom's help, of course. Dawson played baseball from Little League on up. He was a pitcher and a catcher for Quitman High School baseball team, and he played soccer for 3 years at Quitman High School. Dawson's favorite hobbies are sitting in a duck blind or coon hunting with his dog Trip. You can ask Megan about this fact, because she will tell you that is true. In high school, he was a member of Fellowship of Christian Athletics and president of the FFA. He graduated Quitman High School Friday night, and he plans to go to Meridian Community College in the fall for 2 years, and then Against his brother's advice, we are Ole Miss fans. He will attend Mississippi State to become a wildlife biologist or maybe just coon hunt, since there is some coon hunting up that way. Amen. We want to present to you Dawson.
Here's to you. You were pink or blue, and everything I wanted. Here's to you, never sleeping through from midnight till the morning. Had to crawl before you walked, before you ran, before I knew it. You were trying to free your fingers from my hand, 'cause you could do it on your own. Now somehow slow down. Won't you stay here a minute more? I know you wanna walk through the door, but it's all too fast. Let's make it last a little while. I pointed to the sky, and now you wanna fly. I am your biggest fan. I hope you know I am. But do you think you can somehow slow down? Here's to you, every missing tooth, every bedtime story. Here's to Barbie cars, lightsaber wars, sleeping in on Sunday. Had to crawl before you walked, before you ran, before I knew it. You were teaching me the only thing love can. Hold hands through it when it's scary. You've got me. Let's slow down. Won't you stay here a minute more? I know you wanna walk through the door, but it's all too fast. Let's make it last a little while. I pointed to the sky, and now you wanna fly. I am your biggest fan. I hope you know I am. But do you think you can somehow slow down? Please don't roll. used to you, never sleeping through from midnight till the morning. Had to crawl before you walked, before you ran, before I knew it. You were trying to free your fingers from my hand, 'cause you could do it on your own. Won't you stay here a minute more? I know you wanna walk through the door, but it's all too fast.
I just wanna let you know I love you and proud of you and all your accomplishments graduating high school and all. I love you.
Stephen Curtis Waltman. Stephen Curtis Waltman is the son of B.J. and Angela Waltman and the brother of Billy Waltman. He has attended Living Word his whole life of over 18 years. Yeah, I remember first time I saw him, he was like a little fella. He had diapers on. That's a long time ago. Stephen will be graduating from Enterprise High School with honors. He's been an active member of FCA, Future Christian Leaders of America, Beta Club, FBLA, Future Business Leaders of America, and SAD, Students Against Destructive Decisions. Stephen's been on the student council of every one of these clubs, mentioned at least once since beginning his freshman year. He's also been involved, but not limited to, the class of 2016 student council as the vice president for 2 years in a row. While Stephen has enjoyed numerous activities the whole of his life, too many to name, his greatest loves consist of his faith, art, and music. He has loved getting to know himself through expressing not only who he is, but also who God is making him to be. He has also enjoyed his years of successful growth while being a member of the EHS Choir, EHS Piano, Combiata Choir, Cooper's Chapel Praise Team, and the Living Word Praise Team. Through these experiences, Stephen has made lifelong connections that will forever be a part of who he is and who he hopes to become. Fundamentally, this has all led him to discovering the beginning of God's plan for his life. So Stephen is now planning to further his education while attending Lee University in Cleveland, Tennessee, while majoring in world missions and minoring in music. He says that he is excited to trust the Lord and is eager to dive into this next and eventful adventure. We present to you Stephen Waltman.
Set the light. circumstance, they don't really matter. Look far out, tomorrow in his hands. But when I will see a shepherd boy, God may see a king. Even though your life seems filled with I pray that God would fill your heart with dreams.
We've graduated a lot of kids through this church, and you know, it is so awesome to be able to have this kind of kid, who now is no longer a kid, growing up to be an adult, in this place. And I just feel like that we need to pray over them. Would that be okay? Because I believe that there's a destiny. I don't know that I've ever experienced this before at graduation time with, and all of our kids are special and all of our kids have destiny. But there's just something here this morning that I believe that we are actually commissioning them today. I feel like this is a commissioning forth by the Spirit of the Lord. So I just want to invite a few of you to come that know these couples and just gather by their side and gather around them. Matter of fact, can I ask y'all just to step up a couple of steps so they can get behind you as well? If y'all just take a step up. And there's just some of you who know them, if you want to gather around them. And I believe we need to lay hands on visitors invited. You're not visitors. You know, you're part of the family here. We're the family of God. And, you know, it's amazing what God wants to do. Because I believe God has a destiny for these two young men. And every step that they take from this, you can get in front of them. Every step they take from this moment is going to be steps that are either moving toward God or they're moving away from God. And I believe that they're going to move toward God. But I believe that we as believers here have a part to play in these two young men and praying for them and interceding for them and letting God speak to us to speak to them. Because see, God will use you as a catalyst or as a word of encouragement or in many different ways to help them as they move forward in life. Because there'll be times of disappointment. There'll be times of great test. There'll be times of great trials. But Father God knows what He's doing here today. And so I just want you to extend your hands to Him. If you can lay your hand on somebody behind you. And Mike, can you reach? You can't reach both of them. But Mike, I just want you to be the contact person. Let's pray over Dawson first. And if you'll just lay your hand on Dawson. Father, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, Jeremiah, the scripture was so right. For I know the plans I have for you, son. Plans to prosper you and plans to not harm you. Plans to give you a future and a hope. And God, we just stir up and activate it every gift that's in Dawson Denham this day, God. Lord, we call for the deeper things of God to begin to rise up from His innermost being because, Lord, He is a catalyst into the spiritual realm, God, where You want to take people who have sat and laid dormant for so long, God. He is going to be our Joshua, Lord, as He leads a new generation of believers, God, into the kingdom of heaven, Lord. Old, young, I see people come from every tribe and every nation who are coming to experience this new kingdom living, God, that You're going to produce in this young man. So, Lord, all we are here, we're in one accord, we're in agreement this day, God. We believe that the supernatural anointing of the Holy Spirit is raining down right now over Dawson. And so, God, we take our hands, and as our hands are imparting, we say, God, let Your Spirit flow through him in every action, every behavior, every decision that he makes. And, Lord, we also pray in the future. We pray in advance of him, God, that every person that he comes in contact to will either be a person who will mentor him and continue to take him forward. And we thank you for it, Lord. And we seal him all up through the power of the Ruach HaKodesh. And everybody in the house said, amen. Now, don't go away. Let's lay hands on Stephen. Mike, if you'll just step over and lay your hand on him. He's got his... Okay. And let's pray over. If y'all just step back and let Mike step up just a minute and just be our proxy. So, Father, right now in the name of Jesus, over Stephen. Oh God, what a ride he is going to have the rest of his life, Lord, because he is now going to be free to experience all of those things, those desires and those dreams that you have planted in his heart through all the years, God. We know that it's going to be Katie bar the door because Stephen is on the move, God, because you have given him strategies that I see written down in a book. He has been writing in a book for years, Lord, plans and dreams and things that you've spoken, and he's read them back over and said, boy, that's pretty crazy, but God, you said, no, son, those are my plans, those are my dreams, those are my strategies, because there's a new day on the horizon, and you're going to supersede anything that has gone before you, because my hand is heavy upon you, says the Lord, and you will speak forth the oracles of God, and you will decree and declare things, and you will stand, and you will be in that position that I have called you to be, says the Lord, because this is the day of your breaking out, says God. And so, Lord, we just seal him as our hands are touching him, God. We say, Lord, let impartation flow into him. Let the Spirit of God begin to move in him, God. And, Lord, take him places he's never gone before. Do things in his heart and do things in his life, God, that he never dreamed was possible. And, Lord, we just seal him up right now, Father, through the power of the Ruach HaKodesh, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, amen. Now, before you move, I just want to see, does anybody have a word for either one of these young men? Anybody have a word? Anybody hear a word from the Lord for them? Do you?
I just want to say that God has given them their wings and it's time to fly.
Amen. Got wings. Amen. We're expecting big things. Anybody else want to encourage them? The church has a small token of their love for you both. And we just want to tell you how proud we are of you. And we just know God's grace and his love and his mercy, you know, is going to follow you all the days of your life. And you're going to be established in your own houses of the Lord. And like I said, church is changing. Times are changing. We're going into the future. And I believe there's new dimensions that both of you are going to bring into the kingdom of God if we all live. And I believe we're still here for a little more living. Amen. So thank you both very much. I want you to stand and give them a great big round of applause. Thank you, Lord. You can be seated if you want to. I love you, too. You have to do it too. He did it yesterday. Praise God. They are big men, aren't they? Yeah. I believe they were part of that. If they had been born in the medieval age, they would have been knights because of their size. They're so awesome. But anyway, turn with me to Matthew. I don't need that. The Lord rewrote my message today anyway, because I'm just going to give you three little things that I feel like are really important to you as you begin to move forward into the plan and the destiny that God has established for you. See, every one of us in here have destiny. We have reason and rhyme. If all we did was live our life and get up every morning and do the same things over and over again, go to work, come home, you know, take a bath, eat supper, do all that stuff and start back over and do the same thing over, life can become a drudge. But thank God he brought Jesus and he gave us what is called the abundant life. And so as we live abundantly, I believe the church is transitioning into a new era. And I believe that those that are stuck in tradition and rut and rote and routine and who are afraid to get out of what we call the church box of coming in and doing the same things and going out, I believe that you're going to be left behind. And when I say left behind, I'm not necessarily talking about when the king comes and then he takes us all away. I'm talking about being left outside of the kingdom, looking into something new that God is doing. Because see, there's new wineskins in the earth today. You two are part of a new wineskin, a production of new wine that is in the earth today that dares to be different, that it is not afraid of stepping out of the comfort zones of what we know as the status quo church. But because your new wine is got to be put in new skins, God's having to raise up generations of younger people who can catch the vision. And actually, he's even using some old people. I feel like I'm an old person that's being used to be able to see where God is opening up the door of a new wave of his glory, because people are tired of doing church. Amen. So you don't have to amen or shout me down. These two understand what I'm saying, because they've grown up in the church just like a lot of us have. And we there's just, you can go sometimes and it's so full of the Spirit and so awesome. And then most of the time you go and it's like dead Dora. You know, it's just no, like, kind of like it is right now with y'all just sitting here looking at me, listen, okay? But you understand that there's a Spirit of God that's in us, that's in these kids, and they just look at what we do and say, I'm going on past that. I'm going to something different. So three things that I want to remind you to do. In Matthew chapter 5, we see where what being a disciple truly is. A disciple in simplicity is simply a student of a leader or a rabbi, or it's a person who's growing and learning. So all of your life you've been in school, you've been in a school of training. It's parallels with the spiritual world. So when we come into the kingdom of God, there is a parallel world called the spirit world that looks a lot like the natural world, the things that we do in the natural world, going to school, you know, sitting under tutors. That parallels in the spiritual world, because as we come to Jesus, we give our heart to him, and now we become a disciple in Matthew chapter 5. I'm not going to read it to you because it's the Beatitudes. You know, change your bad attitude and be this, if you don't know what that is. So he begins to give them instructions as he calls the disciples. You were called at an early age. So God has had you in training since you were little. And the great thing is that you have stayed and hung in there in this thing, this animal we call the church world, and you've survived. You are survivors. Hallelujah. How many can give me a great big amen on that? Yeah, we all feel that way, don't we? Especially us older ones that have made it through. We have seen so much change. So Jesus brings his students in, the 12 disciples, and he begins to teach them how to grow up in him and how to mature, how to make responsible decisions. I'm speaking to all of us today because there's a whole lot of people in the church world today that have gone to church all their life and they still hadn't graduated. They still hadn't reached a place where they're making right choices and right decisions. And it's because we have not followed the teachings of our Lord. And so you've been under tutorship in the school systems and you've had to learn what authority is. So Jesus tells us three things there. He says, first of all, that when you graduate, you know, I've got to train you in this way so that you will learn things about life. Number one, you should learn not to be haughty and lifted up in verse 3 of chapter 5. He said, you should comfort those that mourn. In other words, you should be kind to people. You should feed people who are hungry and thirsty. You should show mercy instead of showing vengeance all the time. So he began to teach them the ways of the kingdom. I would to God today that we, as all believers in the house of God, would go back to Matthew chapter 5 and learn how to take on the attributes, the qualities of Jesus Christ that he's been trying to teach us, instead of taking where we are now, where we are. He called you to be peacemakers. He called you to have pure hearts. He called you to be persecuted when you stand up for the kingdom of God, when you stand up for Jesus. So those are things he has embedded and implanted in both of your hearts since you've been growing up in the kingdom of God. And so those are qualities that every person must learn. And I believe that you've learned most of those pretty well. We all have to work on them, don't we? So are we a finished product?
No.
No, we are not a finished product, so we all have to work on them. Then that was part one, so that's like elementary school. If you don't learn the basics, you can't go on to middle school and then to high school, right? So it's the same way in the kingdom, folks. And some of us may have to turn around and go back to elementary school, but it'll be okay. We'll learn it. So these guys have got it. I believe they have it. So they go on to part two. Part two says, now that you've got the basics down, then you are to do this. You are to be the salt of the earth. When church is flat, when church is dry, when people aren't spiritually prepared to come in and worship, you are to be salt. You are to throw some God flavor into the atmosphere. And as you throw that God flavor into the atmosphere, then the entire atmosphere will change. Right now, I'm feeling it right now, changing it just by speaking those words out. Your words are so powerful that when you become salt, you will no longer look at all the mundane and the carpets and who's here and what they're wearing and all that. No, you will be men of purpose. Your purpose is you got the basics down, and now you're going to learn how to take those basics and you're going to learn how to throw it out over the earth. And every person you come in contact with, you will be salt to them. You will add something that has been missing in their innermost being. You will provide them and be the salt of the earth. We know what it says there, but if you lose your salt, you've lost your flavor. I just want to throw it out to all of you. How many have lost your flavor this morning? How many, you know, when you look around yourself and you think about your mindset and your attitude, then you need to have a wake-up call, because you need to remember that you've forgotten how to be salt. And when you don't put salt out there, you don't get yourself salted. Amen? And so you need to learn how to continue to be salt and go back to salt. You know what? Salt spices things up. Don't you love salt? Don't you love Lowry's seasoning salt that's got more than just one kind of salt in it? It's got a bunch of stuff in there. And so I can see y'all as catalysts. I can see crusades, okay? I can see crusades. Do you hear me? That means going out into the middle of the street and setting up a sound system or whatever, or a microphone, and begin salting the community. See, this community needs salt flavor. Why? Because we've let drugs come in. We've let all kind of perversions come in. We've let everything in the earth come into our city, and it is taking over. But we, as the people of God and as salt, can make a change in this entire region. Do you hear that? Do you believe that today? I believe that with all of my heart. So your second part is to be salt. So I've got a part to play. Now I got kindness down. I can be kind to that one when they speak to me, you know, like I speak to some of you sometimes, okay? And I'll just repent over that, but I repent to you all the time anyway, so you know I love you, but sometimes I may not just always say the right thing, right? But you love me anyway, right?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, so we move on. So the third thing he tells us is that once we've begun to get the basics and we've gotten the salt, we understand that what we say will affect everything around us. Do you believe that today? I really believe that. So that means when I say to cancer that is killing my sister, I can say to cancer, cancer, salt is fixing to dry you up from the root, and it's going to happen. Why? Because I believe it, and I am settled in the basics. I know there's certain things I must not move away from. If I move away from those certain basic elementary principles, then I'm messed up, okay? And I have to start all over again. But we're now salt. The third thing I want to tell you just real quickly, and this is really good for me, I'm going fast. The third thing that he wants you to be is in verse 14, and he says, you are light. Don't you love those movies where they, those sci-fi movies where all of a sudden, you know, something will come in the room or they'll transport from one place to the other and they'll boom and it'll be a flash of light or it'll be a great big blinding light or, you know, don't you love all that? Can't you see us in a video game as Christians in the earth being salt and being in light and having our swords and going around from place to place and we see somebody that... somebody else is down and I'm starting to preach. I know it. Should I apologize? No. You know, can't you see that? Can't you see the salt in us coming out, zinging out of light off of the end of our swords, the word of God? And we see that person that needs a zing right there and we say, light in the name of Jesus. And they're like, whoo, I got it. Man, that did something to me. So I'm just a fool for Christ. That's all I can tell you. I'm just a fool for Christ. I don't care what things look like. But what I do care is to know that I'm reaching the point where I feel like God can trust me. And that's what graduation is about. See, when you reach this age, you've been through basics. You've been through the middle school. And then you move on to graduation. So let's see how they graduated. That was really good, wasn't it? All we need to do is just remember those few things. So now turn with me over to chapter 10 in Matthew. I'm almost through. Matthew chapter 10. Graduation day! Glory to God. Free at last. I no longer have to be pulled around by what mom and dad says. I can be on my own. I can do my own thing. I can be salt or I can be blah. I can be light. Or I can be darkness. You know, it's just up to you where you go from here. And here's what happened to the disciples, the students who were ready to graduate. In chapter 10 in verse 1, it says, and when he called his 12, he had 12 at that disciples to him, he gave them power over unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sicknesses and, listen to this, I can't stay up there, all kind of diseases. Graduation day. Where are you today? Sitting here. Where are you? Every person in this church has a time in the kingdom of God where they move from elementary to middle school to maturity, where God can trust them. So now he's given you a mandate. He says you got to remember the basics. You got to remember to watch your mouth, who you associate with, and who you listen to. And then you got to be light so that you're not doom, despair, and agony on me in the kingdom. I'm going to tell you something, church. We've been too much doom and gloom. It is time to arise. And it's time to preach what God has already settled. And so now he's given you power. Whatever you say, whatever you do, will reflect salt, light, or power. See, you got to have all three. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Isn't that awesome today? So we send you out, but we don't send you as just going off to college and finding your niche in your workplace or whatever it is. We don't send you out like that today. I felt like today was a commissioning day for both of you because God has a strategic position and place in his kingdom that he wants you to move in. He's keeping you here, and there's rhyme and reason in that, but he's sending you off, and there's rhyme and reason in that. So I know that as you go out and you begin to get in your places, that God, the doors of opportunity that God is opening up for you, here's what I believe. And I'm just going to speak it out of my mouth. I'm going to be salt, I'm going to be light, and I'm going to be power right now, okay? Because I believe that as you go out, you're coming back to this county and this city to help transform what God wants to do. Is that okay? They don't like that. They're not sure about that. And that's okay. Put it on the shelf. Okay? And we will see whether that was God. I'm teaching you how to listen and weigh out. You don't believe everything everybody tells you, but I believe you're going to be catalyst in this area, maybe in the state. It'll be more than one state because it'll spread out. See, I believe God's chosen a place in the South. I really do. And I believe it's here. And it's going to go out from here. And I'm not saying this church. I'm saying this geographical area right here. And it's going to be done collectively. And you're going to be part of the tools that help bridge the gaps between churches and denominations and individual people. And that's heavy, isn't it? Woo! Somebody shake that off. That felt heavy. But it's not. It's light. Because there's a responsibility in that to be what? To learn the basics. To learn how to flavor people. And to learn how to be light and thin. To learn how to operate in power. Amen? All right. Just give the Lord some praise. Because we're getting ready to go somewhere else. Can we do that? Can we, instead of clapping, you know, that, can we just throw our hands up and say, Hallelujah! Woo! Graduated again.